The lone wolf stuff stays behind 6. The SN1 reaction is the unimolecular cousin of the SN2 substitution reaction. Although similar on the surface, they work in very different ways. Where SN2 works in one quick, irreversible step, SN1 takes a more leisurely route. As with SN2, the important characters in SN1 are an alkyl substrate, a nucleophile, and a leaving group. To initiate an SN1 reaction, the leaving group must first leave of its own volition. Because nature prefers neutrality, making 2 formal charges is a tall order. This is, unsurprisingly, the slowest step in the reaction, and the rate equation reflects this. Only the substrate is taken into account. Once the intermediate is formed, the nucleophile is free to attack from either side. The most distinctive part of an SN1 reaction is the carbocation intermediate. Carbocations are highly unstable. Their formation is the rate-limiting step and is responsible for the rate of reaction. This is, however, mitigated by the inductive effect. More substituted carbocations are more stable and, by extension, easier to make, which imparts a faster reaction rate. The inclusion of a carbocation in the mechanism has a lasting effect on the reaction. Many SN1 characteristics are built around the carbocation. Because a nucleophile is free to attack from either side, the product is a racemic mixture of the 2 possible isomers. The carbocation intermediate also dictates what substrates are viable for an SN1 reaction. Because tertiary carbons make the most stable carbocation, tertiary substrates will react the fastest. Primary and methyl substrates are generally unviable as SN1 reagents. This intermediate arbitrates what solvents can be used as well. Hydrogen bonding can be used to stabilize the carbocation, making dissociation more favorable. Polar, protic solvents fit the bill, stabilizing leaving groups while contributing hydrogen bonds to the nucleophile. A protic solvent has a hydrogen directly bonded to a very electronegative atom. The large dipole forces hydrogen to find other sources of electrons to recoup the difference. Any exposed lone pair will do. Although it may seem like a dipole interaction at first, hydrogen bonding does have some covalent character. When in a hydrogen bond, the bond lengths are equal and there is even a sharing of orbitals. Sometimes the carbocation formed isn't as stable as it could be. Carbocation rearrangements are also a consequence of the intermediate, and a possibility when the leaving group occupies a less than optimal position. Depending on the substrate, an unexpected hydride or methyl shift can lead to some surprising products. It seems there's nowhere to hide from the carbocation's effect. The carbocation intermediate is prey for another reaction, the E1 reaction. The two mechanisms are in competition, but for all their fighting, they have a common root. The two mechanisms have an identical opening. The leaving group is ejected spontaneously, leaving a carbocation. Instead of the addition of a nucleophile as in SN1, in an E1 reaction, a base abstracts an adjacent proton, balancing the charge. The problem is most nucleophiles can also act as bases. Both are electron donors, and often what makes a strong nucleophile also makes a strong base. What separates SN1 from E1 is the activity of the electron donor, and because some molecules can have dual activities, the products from both of these reactions often turn up. Like SN2, SN1 is very conditional. Distinguishing between SN2 and SN1 comes down to the specifications of the reaction. The differences in substrates, solvents, and products give clues as to which mechanism is dominant. This still means that the SN1 reaction will produce at least 2 products, and the possibility of competition with an E1 mechanism ensures a mixture of very similar products, which will be very difficult to separate. Depending on what you're working on, conventional means such as chromatography, crystallization, or washing can purify the product at the cost of yield. Resolution of the enantiomers will be difficult more often than not. SN1 should be used when a product is needed at any cost, or when impurities are not a consideration. SN1 carries out substitutions much like SN2, but for all their similarities, they work in very different ways. Where SN2 is unable to perform, SN1 covers the deficit. Between the two mechanisms, any viable leaving group can be directly substituted. When circumstances are less ideal, the E1 mechanism does have the potential to compete with the SN1, and vice versa. Competition between the two unimolecular mechanisms make both difficult to manage. SN1 expands the options for substitutions beyond SN2's limitations, but at a cost. There is a guaranteed mixture of products, even in the most ideal circumstances. For better or for worse, these lone wolves often come as a pair. Join us next time when we'll eliminate the last of these quartet of reactions.